In 1956, one of the founders of the Historical Society, W. Hawkins Ferry, wrote an article called A Suburb in Good Taste. And that article is now a chapter in the book, the Town & Core Volume 1 book. Of the 34 structures mentioned in that book, in that chapter of the book, in that article from the Detroit Free Press, actually, in 1956, of the 34 structures, there are only 13 left. And so it's really, unfortunately, long past time to do something, but there still are a number of significant structures, not just on the lakeshore, but many of the neighborhoods in Grosse Pointe. And we hope to show you tonight what another community has done. And I was born in 1955, and I remember a much different Grosse Pointe in my childhood. Still a wonderful community, but a much different community. And when I went to Newport in 1985 on my honeymoon, and I like to tell my wife that was the favorite day of my honeymoon, but we started the mansions at 8 a.m. when they opened and finished seven of them by 7 p.m. when they threw us out of the breakers. But nonetheless, it brought back such memories of the Grosse Pointe. And I think you'll see that tonight. There was an article in the April issue of the Rob Report that announced what the 10 most affluent communities in the country are. And I'm sorry to say, Mr. Miller, that while Grosse Pointe Farms was number 4, Newport was number 9. But nonetheless, so you can see there's still a lot to like about Grosse Pointe, but we certainly hope to do much more with preservation in the future, particularly you know, as the Grosse Pointe Historical Society. The Historical Society and the Newport, the Preservation Society for Newport County, excuse me, both founded in 1945. And while we've struggled to take care of one home, you'll see that they have 8 and other things. So I think you'll really enjoy this. Paul F. Miller, has been affiliated with the Preservation Society for Newport County since 1977. He has served as Associate Curator prior to his appointment as Curator in 1995. A graduate of John Hopkins University, Mr. Miller has recently been researching French interior decorating firms active in the United States at the close of the 19th century. He has worked on the restoration of the Gothic Room and Marble House, one of the major curatorial projects of the Preservation Society, and he recently published an article called or named Newport at the Gilded Age for the magazine Antiques in 1995. Paul Miller.
First of all, I would like to begin by saying that I think Mike is editing a little bit out of his honeymoon story in favor of National Preservation Week, which is also one of the reasons we've been gathered here and for which I've been invited. Of course, I've been asked to say hopefully a few constructive things on preservation in Newport, Rhode Island, but I don't fear that I can go on too long reciting chapter and verse of national restoration legislation. Rest assured, what I'd like to tell you quite simply is to tell you a story. I know I've been very impressed by many of you in the audience, your acquaintance with Newport and with many of its families. I'm most appreciative, of course, I'm most appreciative of this fabulous setting, which off the record bypasses most clubs in Newport, and in terms of architecture, that is. And also, of course, for the opportunity to try to tell you a little bit about the romance and the almost soap opera saga that involves a cyclical history of Newport, Rhode Island. First of all, there are many interesting common points that I haven't realized until coming to Grosse Pointe. In the 19th century, as you all know, both Newport and the Grosse Pointe were developed along what I might call the 3S concept. They were secular, that is to say, purely residential architecture, seasonal initially, and suburban. So as you can see with the image on the screen, only in very rare instances did Newport's cottage development exceed a standard 10-acre parcel. These lots were plotted on not virgin forest land, but rather on 18th century pasture land, beginning not in the 1850s, but rather at the very dawn of the 19th century. And in every instance, when you look at the parcels here along the cliff walk in Newport, these were never virgin lots. It was a succession of cottages on these lots that were cleared every 20 years, without exaggeration, to answer the rapid pace of America's architectural development, but above all to answer the new cry for the social aspirations of the new client class in America in the 19th century. Today, you are wondering how the Preservation Society supports itself. I'll just briefly give you a nutshell thumbnail sketch of our finances. We have, as of June 1, 11 house museums open to the public, 5 sites, of which all but one are open to the public free of charge. 80% of our revenues are generated by gate receipt. We receive virtually no state or federal grants. Our other major sources of revenue would be our reproductions program, which generates approximately 10%, together with 5% for rentals of selected properties of the society, and the rest comes from our museum store. It's an ever-burgeoning activity, as all of you know, after the proliferation of Metropolitan Museum store annexes. Newport itself has suffered almost as much as Grosse Pointe. And I think I would like to introduce my remarks this evening by saying that it really is a matter of perception. Newport has a cigarette brand named after it, which still survives thanks to the Laurel Arts and Newport cigarettes. Grosse Pointe doesn't have that distinction, but it conjures up, thanks to the Forbes magazine articles, as much of an image of a turn of the century industrial aristocracy as does Newport today. But that image is misleading. When you look at this slide, all of the estates surrounding the breakers, which you'll notice here in the foreground, belong and have belonged to the local Roman Catholic College, 20 estates, since 1945. In all of these instances, the houses were received by the diocese in lieu of inheritance taxes or were acquired outright, never spending more than $20,000. After 1918, no Newport estate sold for more than $100,000 until the year 1973, which marks the arrival of the first condominium conversion on the scene in Newport. Along Bellevue Avenue, the salvation of the houses has been that. Only 7 single-family private summer homes remain today. Newport's summer aristocracy lives in condominiums and either their own converted family estates or in other properties that they have either sympathetically converted or in many cases dramatically altered to allow for increased occupancy. The name recognition, therefore, is a major problem, for expectations do not meet the modern economic reality of the close of the 20th century. And also, what is Newport? For most of you, and I know not all, Newport is the city of the mansions. For many of you still, if you ever served in the US Navy, Newport is one of this country's largest naval installations, best remembered for its torpedo research facilities, underwater research facilities, together with its having quartered from the First World War through 1973 the Atlantic Fleet. So here you see an entirely different landscape of Newport, and one it may intrigue you to know has caused a problem for preservation from the outset. For as an average taxpayer in Newport, you quickly realize that 50% of the tax base is tax-free, being dependent on the federal government. 1% belongs to the Preservation Society, and 2% belongs to the college, for a total of 53% of the city taxable properties being exempt. Then again, if you fall somewhere in an age range between 18 and 40, you probably know of Newport as a light nightlife capital, and I think this is what Mike was there for on his honeymoon, of southern New England, and also as the best beaches south of the North Shore of Maine, along the coast of New England. And here you have a dramatic view of Second Beach in Newport, together with Hanging Rock, immortalized by John Lafarge in the mid-19th century. Yet again, being in the yacht club, there is Newport of international yachting fame, home of the America's Cup, until its loss in 1983 to Australia and the presentation of the America's Cup to Australia in the Marble House in our so-called trophy room. Probably some of those most major transatlantic developments to this day. As Mr. Bicknell would know, Newport is also the best, perhaps not the best preserved, but the city in North America that offers most pre-revolutionary domestic and public architecture than any other site. Now, one always might associate that claim with a Williamsburg or a Charleston, but Newport boasts between 350 and 400 pre-revolutionary structures in varying degrees of preservation. Then again, this whole issue of Newport is shrouded in mystery and romance. As you can see, it's a problem of not only perception, but also what Newport represents to a variety of audiences. We don't even know, for example, how Newport came to be quite exactly. Newport was, according to the record, settled by Anne Hutchinson and her followers, the first of a long line, although theological, of Newport grand dames in the 1630s. However, in the mid-19th century, Newport's literati, led by Longfellow, looked at this haunting image in the center of the colonial districts of the town and decided that it had to be the vestige of a 12th century Viking watchtower, and so that led to the whole image and the mythology of the Vinland, which name you'll find frequently lives on in Newport, and the fact that Newport must be the lost colony of Leif Erikson. Here you see a very interesting mural done in 1883 by Walter Crane, who together with Burne Jones and their superior William Morris were engaged by Catherine Lorillard Wolfe, one of the decorators of a great Newport villa, great art patrons of the period, one of the major members behind the creation of the Metropolitan Museum in New York, to try to personify that myth, to try to answer what Newport could possibly mean. For in the 19th century, Newport was not, like Grosse Pointe, developed as a resort city. It was a pre-existing city, which in the 18th century had been the third largest in North America after Philadelphia and Charleston. Sadly, as I'm sure you realize, the basis of that economic wealth was the slave trade, or the triangle trade, with its collapse at the close of the 18th century, but above all with the flight of the loyalist merchants from Newport at the conclusion of the war for independence. Newport never recovered its economic might. Rather, it began to slumber in a state of economic decrepitude. It was exactly this cyclical economic collapse that in the early 19th century drew the eye of the romantic poets led by Longfellow and the artists led by John Lafarge, William Morris Hunt, Kensett Church, the Hudson River School. They found in the derelict quality of all these 18th century houses a rather unique design source. Add to that the splendid natural site. And what resulted was a mythologizing, as we see now, not only the Viking Tower, but on the whole issue of Newport's old town. And thus, Newport begins a sense of historic preservation before the fact by the conclusion of the Civil War. I bring back on the screen now the Viking Tower because it was one of the first grassroots preservation efforts. Again, only because this tower had been romanticized by the Boston literati, a local group of councilmen decide to buy the pasture land around the tower, landscape it, perpetuate the myth of the Vikings, and create this first homage, if you will, to a sense of the past. Ironically, in the 20th century, we know now, and apologies to Greenfield Village, that this is really a remnant of a stone windmill of the 1630s. Therefore, Mr. Ford's may not be the earliest windmill in America, but this, imagine, if you will, had a superstructure with sails and with a turnstile. You can visualize perhaps a structure dominating the hills in the 17th century. And the more the artists and literati most romantic of sites was Bishop Barclay's homestead, Whitehall, of the 1720s, located just outside of the city line. It was bequeathed to him in his will to Yale University, which is very active in founding. Yale University, in turn, deeded the property to one of the first organizations active in preservation in North America, which unfortunately, and I don't know if you're familiar with them in Grosse Pointe, never quite gets their due, and that organization is, of course, the Colonial Danes. The Colonial Danes arrived on the scene, they rescued the property, and began by the third quarter of the 19th century to try to interpret the house as an early 18th century gentleman's country retreat and to begin its restoration. This preoccupation with Newport's colonial past began to have a tremendous impact on the national scene, and particularly for an audience in Grosse Pointe at the close of the century. For as you know, by the conclusion of the Civil War, Newport's cottage colony began to expand around the periphery, and there were enormous opportunities for the best of America's architects to create the best in the latest residential trends. Those architects, after the centennial in Philadelphia in 1876, began to ask themselves what would constitute a Native American style. What, of course, do we have that is so unique? And architects began to look around New England. In 1873, Charles Colin McKim, of the firm of McKim, Mead and White, probably needing no introduction, did a photographic survey of Newport's architecture. And by the close of the 1880s, he would combine all the colonial Newport forms that he so admired with a good eye for architectural detail into something that was, although embellished, would have a tremendous impact on the evolution of the American architectural scene, and that is this house, the H.A.C. Taylor House, built by McKim, Mead, and White at the close of the 80s. It is the very first colonial revival house in America, and you probably know that there were at least a half dozen houses in Grosse Pointe in the 1890s that were copied quite literally directly from it. Sadly, that house was demolished in the 1950s. Then the city itself began to wonder what it could do for historic preservation. But as you may gather, the city in the 19th century was not sure on its own economic base, having been a great seaport, international seaport of the 18th century. The city was now seeing that it had reinvented itself as the social resort for the so-called 400. Yet they still yearned for the romance of the great families of the 18th century. And I perhaps also, for an audience like this, don't need to tell you that the leading merchants in Newport of the 18th century, because of the religious freedom granted by Anne Hutchinson and to a lesser degree by Roger Williams, were Jewish, wealthy Jewish families from the West Indies. They built not the oldest congregation, but the oldest synagogue in North and South America in the 1760s. It was built by America's only professional architect of the 18th century, Peter Harrison. Sadly, most of the Jewish families felt that Republican America would be hostile. They therefore fled to New York or to Canada. There was not a Jewish population in Newport by 1805. What the city of Newport did was hope for the return of the Jewish families. They used a testament left by one of the last of their descendants to maintain, through the early 20th century, an empty synagogue in the hopes that a Jewish population would return. Eventually, one did on the eve of World War I, and the synagogue was then turned over to the new Russian immigrants and rebaptized. But it was a leap of faith on the part of the city to preserve this important civic 18th century structure that shows the urbane quality of 18th century life in Newport. In terms of private initiative, well, not every family that was upgrading into one of the newer and larger and more opulent houses of those gunfire decades of the 19th century was was leveling your house to make way for the new cottage, the King family, for example, of Newport in New York, realized after the publication of this house and a series of books by Andrew Jackson Davis, that the house had become an icon for style that in America was baptized the Italianate style. Built in the close of the 1840s by the architect Richard Upjohn, and launched the move for the so-called Tuscan revival, projecting tower, bracketed eaves. You know the house from so many parallels in the immediate Detroit area. Well, they decided, the King family, since the house was outmoded, not to tear it down. Instead, they gave it to the city as an early form of preservation, and the city converted it into a public library, which remained until the 1950s. Unfortunately, not everyone was quite as philanthropic. The Metropolitan Museum, of which virtually the entire executive committee were Newport summer residents, realized that there's a lot of good and derelict 18th century architecture out there. So the Metropolitan Museum, thinking that this architecture would vanish, began to buy up houses. And one of those bought for the first of the period rooms of the 18th century in the Metropolitan was the Metcalf Bower House, which you see here on the screen being demolished in the 1920s so that its period rooms could be rescued and transferred to the Metropolitan Museum. Luckily, some of Newport and Rhode Island's oldest families had come into a bit of money in the 19th century thanks to the textile industry, and they began to take a stand. As you can see through the intervention, really, of the organizations like Colonial Danes, individuals turning over their properties, this was a case-by-case response. There's no coordinated effort of preservation on the whole yet in the early 20th century, nor in the late 19th. Rather, it's a response to certain key crises. But along came a sugar daddy in the early 20th century, the person of John Nicholas Brown, whose father had died when Mr. Brown was an infant. He came into a colossal sum of money, and he came under the influence of a name you might recognize in Grosse Pointe, a medievalist named Ralph Adams Cram. Mr. Cram was a spiritual sort who began to advise a young teenage John Nicholas Brown that he'd better react and start to rescue some of Newport's signature buildings. So Mr. Brown bought the 1772 Brick Market, once the City Hall, formerly a theater, multi-purpose structure, one of the great Palladian buildings of 18th century America, and he converted it into a boutique. He also bought and restored America's oldest library, the Redwood Library, and the Quaker Meeting House of 1698, the oldest Quaker a place of worship in North America. And finally, something you'll probably recognize, Trinity Church, the oldest Anglican church north of Virginia, 1726. Again, all of these are single individuals responding to a perceived need, and on the screen now you have the dynamo behind John Nicholas Brown, father of J. Carter Brown, as many of you may know, in his later life. This is John Nicholas Brown, who was to prove a great friend of the Preservation Society. As all of this was going on, as you know all too well from Grosse Pointe, American society was changing as well. By World War I, a distinct problem began to arise with the introduction of the permanent income tax. Not only that, but also because of the drought, there was something known as the servant problem, the absence of sufficient and skilled labor pools. And then finally, there was quite honestly the creation of newer, more casual resorts in the South where the season was prolonged and the lifestyle did not entail $800,000 seasonal entertainment budgets, nor fast servants and, of course, eight-course formal dinners every evening when in residence. Here you see the servants revolting, asking for some free time at the Elms, dawn of the 20th century, and Mr. Berwin responding, the owner of the Elms, with an offer to increase their pay. They say they only want additional days off. He refuses. They strike. They are fired. at one and the same time knew with the menace of the First World War, the naval installations which had existed in Newport since the days of John Paul Jones sensed a need for expansion. Because the harbor of Newport has never required dredging and is the deepest natural channel in New England, over 150 feet in depth, the Navy saw the strategic possibilities of the city and began to accordingly expand. Here you see Goat Island in the center of the harbor of Newport. No longer are we noticing a harbor dominated by the great pleasure yachts, the 120-foot steamships that closed the 19th century, but rather a harbor dominated by defense-related smokestack industries, torpedo factories, and a naval destroyer squadron. Newport began to move away from being a resort and began by 1920 to reinvent itself as a smokestack naval industrial center. What this did, of course, to the quaintness of the 18th century districts, I think is quite obvious. Beneath all of these signs, believe it or not, are wonderful 18th century buildings running through buildings of the 1860s. The ultimate need for expansion was the drawing card which really led to the creation of the Preservation Society. In 1945, the Goat Island torpedo factories decided that they needed to expand onto the mainland, and they began to condemn 18th century houses dating primarily from the 1720s through the 60s, built by the leading Quaker merchant families of Newport of the early quarter of that century. Most of those houses, as you can see on the screen now, had been Victorianized. So they were not really recognized as being important, intact, or necessarily elegant specimens of 18th century architecture until, yet again, the Metropolitan, luckily for them, knocked on the door of this property, the Hunter House of 1749, and said, well, if it's going to be demolished for a naval parking lot, then we would like to rescue the paneling. That was the proverbial straw that broke the camel's back, and you'll find that, again, the townspeople were not really in the forefront. They were trying to follow the wave, determine what the tide of the future would be for the community. Rather, it was the summer colony that had led the forefront of the attack. Primarily led by the Grand Dames, yet again, of Newport society, the summer colony had both the capital, the connections, and the free time to spearhead a restoration effort. Catherine Urquhart Warren of New York, New Orleans, and Newport decided to band together a friends of the summer colony and rescue only the Hunter House. Now, she was a good friend of Harry DuPont's. What she hoped to do with the house was in many ways something that Mr. Ford did with Greenfield. She wanted to move the house to a block that she would buy, move in lots of tradespeople, try to recreate the 18th century towns and yards, furniture making, cabinetry shops, have an example of an 18th century blacksmith shop, and do this in a conveniently located block downtown and see if that would work. Luckily, she began to talk to other friends, and what she decided to do was, for the time being, canceled. She simply bought Hunter House out of her own pocket and let it lie still. And then she went and saw the granddaughter of Cornelius Vanderbilt II, a very fascinating woman who lived in the Breakers, named the Countess Laszlo Szeszegi. And she said, well, if we're trying to start a preservation movement in Newport, I don't think that we will get much in terms of tourism. Tourism, as you can probably realize, in Newport is between in season for our properties alone 800,000 and 1 million people in registered gate receipts. But it wasn't that obvious in 1947. So what she asked the Countess Szeszegi to do, and this was really on the advice of preservationists in Williamsburg and elsewhere, was to lease the Breakers for a token sum of $1 a year, with all the monies from gate receipts gained thereby going into a pool of funds which could be used to secure 18th and 17th century houses. By that I mean it was never her intent to keep the properties in perpetuity. What initially she was intending to do was to restore the properties, roll them over with protective covenants to sympathetic private buyers. Countess Ashady proved to be sympathetic, particularly since she was trying to get rid of the breakers, which was costing the family a tremendous amount of money. It had been offered to Franklin Roosevelt as early as the mid-1930s. Unfortunately, Mr. Roosevelt was then negotiating the purchase of yet another Vanderbilt estate that was an abutter of his in Hyde Park, New York, the Frederick Vanderbilt estate, which was rolled over to the National Park Service. Therefore, logically, the National Park Service did not want the breakers, and the only solution for the Vanderbilt family was to take the house off the tax rolls, pay its maintenance, but let the Preservation Society operate it, and 26,000 people, to everyone's astonishment, particularly native Newporters, showed up in Newport, Rhode Island in 1947 to tour that property. With the funds thereby gained, Hunter House was restored, and eventually over 30 other 17th and 18th century houses. This is the Vernon House, General Rochambeau's headquarters during the French Revolution of 1770. This is the Pitshead Tavern of 1726, the White Horse Tavern, the oldest in America, of 1673, were restored and sold with covenants to private buyers. To help to foster this program, the oldest reproductions program authorized by a preservation organization was founded in Newport in the 1940s. And initially, as you can probably gather, with Kittinger and Schumacher, its focus was on 18th century Newport decorative arts. Today it has evolved into a completely different program. And then Catherine Warren, looking at the numbers of people who were beginning to visit Newport, began to realize, as other preservationists, Mr. Chorley included, had advised her, perhaps there's something of interest here in Newport that we don't quite get. She began to take long walks around the colonial districts of Newport, began to realize that there was more there than she had readily realized. And so with the good graces backed by the checkbook of Mr. Maxim Karolik, a book, a survey of Newport's architecture spanning the years 1640 through 1925, was published by the Preservation Society in 1952. The names of the authors probably will need no introduction and become nationally prominent. Vincent Scully of Yale and Antoinette Downing, and I was mentioning this to someone earlier, of Ohio. The entire preservation movement statewide in Rhode Island was begun by a group from Ohio. The only outside New England influence was William Sumner Appleton, who in 1910 founded the Society for Preservation of New England Antiquities. But Mr. Appleton had actually, in fact, only bought and rescued one 18th century house in Newport. And then Mrs. Warren and her friends began to realize, well, if the architecture is interesting, what about the decorative arts that were in these houses? So she commissioned a young man named Mr. Ralph Carpenter, who has gone on to become the dean of 18th century American furniture, to study the work of the Townsend Goddards, and a whole field of expertise was born. Luckily, as I mentioned, the ladies of society in Newport of the period did still have the connections in New York, so corporate sponsors were found for annual fundraiser balls. Through the 1950s and 60s, they were invariably either Cadillac or Tiffany. By the late 1950s, the prosperity engendered by the expansion of the Navy base had created a boom in Newport's population. The population of the city proper had practically doubled with people working on the factory assembly lines. It was therefore decided by the city that some of the estate districts should be rezoned commercial, the primary reason being, if you recall from the earlier slide, that the heart of the old colonial downtown was rebaptized Blood Alley. It was a tight concentration of houses of ill repute, tattoo parlors, and rather colorful bars. The city therefore decided to condemn the lower reaches of Bellevue Avenue, rezone these estates commercial. Here you see the estate of Gordon Bennett, the Hearst of the 19th century, and founder of the International Herald Tribune, a house by McKinley White, site in immaculate condition in 1957, cleared within the same year for the first of two shopping centers on Bellevue Avenue. Now, up to this point, and since the early 19th century, any attempt at preservation in Newport had not been geared towards a community at large. It had really been focusing again on a crisis-to-crisis scenario, and then as of 1945, the focus had been on primarily the 17th and the 18th centuries. But when Catherine Warren and her group of hardy followers saw the demolition of Bellevue Avenue, obviously it was going to impact not only their own real estate values, but also it was going to utterly transform the face of Newport as they knew it. Between 1945 and 1970, over 30 major Newport estates were demolished for residential and commercial subdivision. Here you see a Peabody and Stearns Rockhurst demolished for 1 acre tract houses. Villa Rosa by Ogden Kaufman demolished for apartment blocks in 1959. White Home by John Russell Pope, the Garrett Estate, the Baltimore Railroad Barons, demolished by the college for a new 1950s cafeteria. Here you see Horace Trumbauer's Chetwood, later the Astor Estate, demolished in the beginning of the 1970s for quarter-acre tract houses, again on Bellevue Avenue. The city was realizing that these properties were either going to be swept away by institutions and taken off the tax rolls, or condemned. Many of the owners were not unwilling, for example, to pay the high property valuations of the 1940s, the same problem that occurred in Grosse Pointe. So the city therefore simply decided to rezone, and Bellevue Avenue was rezoned for quarter-acre residential lots. The houses were emptied of their contents, and the surviving vanguard began to look, if not to the Preservation Society, then again to charitable organizations. You see, Newport, unlike Grosse Pointe, never and still does not have any regulations on institutional use of structures. So the best scenario was simply to give a house to your religious affiliation. And that is the case with the house on the screen now, which many of you, if you're old-time Grosse Pointers, might think is Rose Terrace. In fact, it's by the same architect, Horace Trumbauer, the same interior decorator, the Paris firm of Carnillon, with the assistance of Joseph Duveen. In 1914, when this house was completed, it was not yet Lord Duveen, and the house was built for the senior member of the Widener family, the Philadelphia Traction Kings, George Widener, who went down, as you know, on the Titanic. His widow, Mrs. Alexander Hamilton Rice, completed the house. And then just as the house was nearing completion during the First World War, she was shocked to learn that his son had married, against her wishes, an older divorcee from Grosse Pointe, Mrs. Horace Dodge One. Mrs. Horace Dodge One, the first wife, excuse me, the first wife of Mrs. Horace, Mrs. Horace Dodge Jr., the first wife of Horace Dodge Jr. So Mrs. Horace Dodge Jr. Brought up her children by Horace Dodge II in this property with her second husband, and therefore, several years later, those children were to recreate Rose Terrace in Grosse Pointe using the same decorator, same art source, and same architect. At Miramar, in every detail, is a copy of the prototype of Miramar, and I'm happy to say it survived. It was given to the Episcopalian Diocese and the Episcopal Diocese and became a school for girls. More recently, it has been bought by a private owner and is again on the tax rolls. And here you see why. It's brilliant interiors. And I'm not sure if Rose Terrace was quite as high-style French, but there are probably some rooms that were similar. Now, the deciding factor to make the Preservation Society move into the 19th century was the sale of the Elms by Park Bennett in 1962. This property was sold for demolition as the third shopping center on Bellevue Avenue for under $100,000. Its contents were sold at a week-long auction. A lot went into local state parks. was a major trauma for the Summer Colony, where the house was one of the key signature properties in the lower Bellevue Avenue quadrant. Luckily, Catherine Warren grouped together over a cocktail party 10 friends, including a few people you might recognize. Again, Mrs. Dodge Widener and Mrs. Harvey Firestone Jr., and each of them pledged $10,000. They bought the house, although stripped of its contents, back from the owners, and within 3 weeks, miraculously, the house was opened as a non-profit museum with loans orchestrated again through the Society Ladies' connections from the Metropolitan Museum, the Boston Museum of Fine Arts, and purchases at the 1960s auctions, where, as probably most of you know, you can still buy fabulous 18th century French things for $200 to $400. I had this earlier slide up because you can recognize many of the Newport inventories in the MGM productions of the 1950s. A lot of the houses that were demolished in New York and in Newport, the furnishings and the architectural interiors were called as props by MGM, and they show up, okay, for example, this commode, this chest of drawers in the Elms, and a lot of Jerry Lewis period films in the 1950s. This is that all-time classic Cinderella, for example, with interiors courtesy of the Elms. Here at the house, I also had a wonderful slide that I regretted not showing you. When the house was inaugurated, Mrs. John Nicholas Brown as a museum, and Mrs. Harvey Firestone, the latter in the lead, began the conga line that marched through the ground floor reception room, surviving up the place. In 1963, Marble House came on the market. Now, according to the press, this first of the great Vanderbilt palaces, considered the most opulent home in America when completed in 1892, it cost $11 million. It was sold in 1933 for $1 to Mr. Frederick H. Prince, and its contents were $99,000, excluding art purchased and resold by Mr. Devine. Through the good graces of Harold Vanderbilt, the Preservation Society bought it for $60,000 in 1962, including all contents. And this is the only of our houses that came with a significant endowment. The entire endowment of the Preservation Society is $5 million, of which no capital is spent. Major repairs are funded by the interest on that $5 million. Our annual budgets, as I've mentioned, funded by gate receipts, are in the area of $10.5 million in 1998. Harold Vanderbilt was therefore one of our most generous donors. And then the Preservation Society began to realize, because of the encroachment of the zoning, that it was crucial to try to organize not just houses, but also site preservation. And so this area, which the city had its eye on for rezoning, again for quarter acre house lots, was purchased. And you can see how important it is for the fabric of the cottage colony on Bellevue Avenue. This is Ravensky Park, owned by the Preservation Society. And this is our 17th century burial ground, Arnold's burial ground in the 1680s. Houses that were bought, and then because they didn't come with an endowment, were rolled over with historic covenants, include this crenellated Gothic house, Alexander Jackson Davis's Malbone of 1849, now returned to the tax rolls. And then in 1969, this beast came on the market. It's a battering ram of a house, but it's the earliest surviving domestic commission by the young Richard Morris Hunt. It's an Italianate house that Hunt revamped between 1873 and 1879 for a China trade family. And not many people saw the importance of the house. It had been left to the Society for the Preservation of New England Antiquities with only a $60,000 endowment by the descendants of its builders. They realized that $60,000 wasn't going to pay the heating bill. They graciously declined the bequest, and the house was available for development. A young person named Miss Doris Duke bought the property for the Preservation Society, again for that psychological sum, that barrier of $100,000, and promptly turned it over as a gift. Now this began a long and very fruitful interchange in Newport. Miss Doris Duke had been brought up in the city. She remembered it in the 1920s and 30s. She had married Mr. Oliver Cromwell and moved to Palm Beach in Honolulu. So she hadn't seen all the Navy expansion and the development. When she returned, for example, in the 1960s, this is again the heart of the colonial district, Thames Street, and I think you can recognize that everything on the right side of the street, without exception, is 18th century. Between 1967 and 1973, hundreds of houses were cleared for HUD 1960s urban renewal. So there you see the townhouse duplexes that have replaced that colonial corridor. And this incensed Doris Duke. She had no stomach for red tape bureaucracy. She realized that she was one step ahead of the bulldozers. So she threw simply a private initiative, her money, her passion, her energy at the problem. And between 1969 and 1973 alone, she bought, restored, and rented as private single-family houses, keeping them on the tax rolls, 90 18th century houses. Now she's come under a lot of criticism of late, not last or least of it being the story of her will, but the houses were generally never removed from their context. They were kept in the urban fabric of Newport. Unfortunately, some of them were beyond repair, as you can see here, and for modern conveniences, she did embellish a good deal, and she really took the houses back to the bones to see how they were constructed. Now, although that might have been an interesting educational exercise, many would now criticize her as having over-decorated the 18th century houses. But I think with the results in this before and after shot, you'll realize just how effective her timely intervention and private intervention was. Newport, being primarily a Quaker town, also never had that archetypical New England concept of a village green. Doris Duke decided to create one. She leveled a smokestack laundry that existed until the mid-1970s to create for the bicentennial in 76 Queen Anne Square. And thus, for the first time in its history, Trinity Church of 1726 sits over a village green. Urban development began to spare Newport but hit the county. So the Preservation Society began to move its net wider. The ferry service, which you see here on the screen now, was begun in the 1630s. But when the Newport Bridge was completed in 1969, the population of the county, again being oceanfront with excellent beaches, etc., tripled. It went up 300% between 1969 and 1979. The Navy in 73, for political reasons, decided to close most of its industrial facilities. Newport knew for a short period 70% unemployment. So the city simply decided to demolish the factories, and Newport, which had had only one hotel prior to 1970, now saw the Goat Island complex developed as a resort community, inspired by Hilton Head. Then in 1973, the Preservation Society began its first fundraiser, again trying to operate independently to create greater freedom of action from federal legislation. The breakers came on the market, and its purchase was negotiated privately. Three independent appraisals were done on the property, including contents. The highest was $403,000. So in 1973, the society bought the breakers from the Vanderbilt heirs, lock, stock, and barrel, although most of the art had already been sold, for $395,000. The same year, which was a banner one, Kingscote was rolled over. It's one of the great Gothic Revival colleges, 1839, by Richard Upjohn in the city. And here, finally, something obvious began to fall into place. It had never been a conscious strategy, but Catherine Warren, now close to retirement, began to realize that the dream evoked in that survey in 1952 of Newport's architectural heritage was coming to fruition. What it was calling for was a representative house from virtually every decade of the 19th century's brilliant evolution of artistic taste. And again, trying to preserve more gardens, not just urban settings, the Preservation Society acquired, was bequeathed Green Animals, a topiary garden in suburban Portsmouth, Rhode Island. And then Rosecliff, one of Stanford White's very last houses, 1902, for a mining heiress from San Francisco, bequeathed to the society in 1970. evoke an entirely new source of revenue for tourism and for diversifying revenues in the Preservation Society, film rentals. In 1973, Newport and Rosecliff was discovered by Paramount Studios, and the two became permanently and lovingly intertwined when The Great Gatsby, starring Robert Redford and Mia Farrow, was set here. Since then, Newport has been the source and setting for everything from Steven Spielberg's recent release, Amistad, to the Betsy, in which Newport plays Grosse Pointe, Michigan, to True Lies, an Arnold Schwarzenegger film. The tradition of Newport knowing how to throw a party also continues with the great yachting regatta balls and the charity events. This is the America's Cup Syndicate Yachting Ball. And our season has been prolonged into the summer. We do open every year into the winter, obviously. We do go beyond the summer now, and we decorate the houses for the winter holidays, and we are ever increasing in terms of bus tours. On an educational front, to try to bring new sympathetic blood to Newport, we've organized a symposium that is sponsored by Christie's Auction House, and that is held every May, and the results have been beyond hopes. Through this and other educational programs, we've been able to lure to Newport such prominent families as the Annenbergs, who have begun major restoration projects and purchase of private estates. Now, I don't mean to imply that everything is rosy. Obviously, tourism brings other problems, police overtime, a major litter situation. But preservation overall has been relatively successful. Again, there have been a few problems. Those of you who know the Country Club of Detroit will recognize perhaps the style of the building in the background. This is John Russell Pope's Bonnie Crest, built exactly the same year as the Country Club of Detroit. But you can see that its last owners, after having cut the main house up into condominiums, weren't happy with that. They were trying to get a little bit more money back from their investment, so they decided to plant some condominiums amidst Olmsted's specimen trees on the grounds of Bonnycrest. And for this reason, we've had a minor setback. Most of the Ocean Drive has been removed from the National Historic Register. But we have bright spots yet again. Chepstow, here on the screen, is one of the ancestral homes of the Morris family of New York, Gouverneur Morris. We are opening this to the public in a matter of 2 weeks. It has fabulous 19th century paintings and Morris family memorabilia. That will represent our house of 1860. It's a pure Italianate house. And this is our 12th addition to our house museums, the great Isaac Bell House, built by McKim Mead White, 1883, for the sister of Gordon Bennett, who, as we know from the previous slide, lived just a few blocks away. It's one of the early and most intact of the great shingle-style houses of America. The final project will be the opening of Doris Duke's Rough Point, on which we're working in collaboration with her own syndicate, and it will be open, I'm glad to say, for the abutters, together with the two previous properties, on a by reservation and a limited access basis, that is to say only 2 days a week. Again, we're trying to work in concert more and more with the city, and we are trying to express a need to be sensitive to the traffic problems and the access problems to those districts of Newport that still remain private and intact. The setting, again, pristine and evocative as it should be. Well, I think I said more than enough, and I'd like to open to a few questions if there should be any, but I'll just summarize briefly. What you've seen in this evolution is that the orchestration of a preservation movement was initially a series of very private battles, a purely private initiative fought on a crisis-to-crisis situation. The first important step in the organization of an architectural appreciation of Newport's built environment and the need for its preservation was the creation of architectural surveys, published surveys by nationally recognized names, which can't be recommended enough. Another factor was a diversification of the holdings. in terms of trying to draw an interesting audience for a preservation movement. One should try to respect and reflect the spectrum of architectural styles of the community and to have an example, if not the best, at least one of each of the important chapters. Another important thing, of course, I haven't mentioned is site management. I've alluded to it. The Preservation Society created the Zoning Board and is its leading funder. The Preservation Society, in fact, contributes $540,000 a year to the city of Newport in lieu of taxes. Protective covenants are created for its properties that are rolled off and returned to the tax rolls. Regional preservation, again, not just the preservation of a built environment, but an attempt, if not directly to politicize yourself, then at least to foster grassroots efforts. Because the Preservation Society has become the leading tourist attraction of southern New England, and because it has therefore become very politicized, we fund grassroots efforts that are more militant preservation alliances that lead the forefront of individual causes for us. A regional preservation, trying to create, together with pre-existing historical societies, a sense of collaboration and a sense of mission. Finally, an important attempt to preserve a sense of private initiative as opposed to a dependency on federal funding. And lastly, diversifying the funding, as you've seen through our example of charity balls, a reproductions effort, occasional rentals, and private donations. In summary, you're probably expecting me to ask if there is a grand dame in the audience, please stand up. That's been the case of Newport's experience, but in just a few words, historic continuity with the past is not a duty, it is only a necessity. Thank you so much.
Rose Terrace was approved for condominiums and it came down. Rose Terrace was a good
the site of the Great Gatsby and it wasn't allowed, so it ended up going to Newport. I mean, there's just so many ties and so many things that we haven't done here that they've been able to do in Newport. And let's hope that 111 Lakeshore Cherryhurst is the last of our losses, and then other people will step forward and do things. But please, if there are no other questions, please join us for refreshments and stay and enjoy the camaraderie here and all the great people.